Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
All right, would you come to order, please? This is the November 16th, 2020, 7 p.m. meeting of Alamance County Board of Commissioners. I'm Chair Amy Scott Daly. With us tonight, present in person, we have Commissioner Bill Lashley, Commissioner Eddie Boswell, and Commissioner Tim Sutton. Joining us remotely by Zoom is Vice Chair Steve Carter. Vice Chair Carter, can you hear me? Okay, great. And we also have our County Manager, Brian Haywood, join us remotely. All right, Vice Chair Carter, could you please lead us in an invocation and the Pledge of Allegiance?
Yes, will you join me in prayer, please? Father God, as we approach you this night, dear Lord, we just seek a peace for our country. We seek a peace for our state and our community. We seek, dear Lord, for us to come together as a nation. We seek, dear Lord, for your wisdom and guidance for this deliberation tonight as we undertake the business of Alamance County, for you to bless us with courage to do the right thing, dear Lord. We ask that you watch over us. Bless all those in attendance tonight and keep them safe as we travel home when we're done. We ask, dear Father, that you be with us all in our deliberations. And we ask all this, dear Lord, in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Join me in the pledge, please.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, the first item of business on our agenda is public speakers who wish to be heard on items that are related to this meeting's agenda. And I understand, Madam Clerk, we do not have anybody who has signed up to be heard. We do have a public hearing, so we'll have those people, there's comments to be addressed at that time. So, there being no public speakers, there's no commissioner responses. So the first item for a vote would be to approve the agenda.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Commissioner Lashley has made a motion to approve the agenda and Commissioner Boswell has seconded it. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Commissioner Carter, did you vote? Or Vice Chair Carter, did you vote? Okay. Thank you. So the motion carries unanimously, Father, Vice Chair Carter voting in the affirmative. And I understand that because we have a person attending remotely, that we have to be a little more particular about announcing how everybody voted. So the next item on the agenda is approval of the consent agenda.
I move.
Second.
Commissioner Lashley has made a motion to approve the consent agenda and Commissioner Boswell has seconded it. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And Vice Chair Carter, how did you vote?
Aye.
So the motion carries 5-0 with Vice Chair Carter voting in the affirmative. All right, the first item for business is a public hearing regarding economic development incentives. Before we jump into that and seek a motion to open the public hearing, because we have one commissioner who is participating remotely tonight, there is a bit of a wrinkle in our procedure. So, Attorney Albright, could you please explain that?
Under the new law that's passed, it may 4th of this year, when the governor has declared an emergency and the council or commission has a public hearing, this new law authorizes the public body to conduct a public hearing by taking action on those hearings at the meeting. However, it adds a requirement that Written comments may be submitted at any time between the notice of the public hearing and 24 hours after the public hearing. The consequence of this requirement is the public hearing, you're going to have a recess. You won't be able to take final action tonight. You'll vote on the public hearing, both of them, and then we will recess the meeting so that the 24-hour rule can be met. And as I understand it, we'll be meeting again on Wednesday and take another vote on these two public hearing matters. And then at that time, this meeting will be adjourned.
Do you guys have a, any commissioners have a question about that? Sure. Is it okay, as far as you are aware, if we reconvene virtually, perhaps at 10 in the morning on Wednesday?
Yes, I'm sure that will be fine.
Okay, great. All right, but Mr. Albright, we can take a vote tonight on these incentives, but they just won't be a final vote.
That's correct. You can take a vote to approve or not approve, but then the public comment comes in, and then you take a final vote.
Great. So, no more questions about that. And are we going to have a presentation about the Chick-fil-A incentives in advance of the public hearing, so I would be a little more aware about what the incentives are?
Yes.
So this would be the time to do that. Is there somebody who wants to present? Okay, great. Hello. Come on up and you would introduce yourself to us and tell us what it is, the scope, what's going on with these economic development incentives proposed for Chick-fil-A.
Great, thank you, Madam Chair. My name is Dave Fader. I'm here to represent Chick-fil-A. Is it appropriate if I remove my mask?
Yes.
So I can
yes.
share
you.
Absolutely.
Thank you. I serve as senior director in our our corporate financial services group. And I represent Chick-fil-A in Project Thunder, and I'll share a little bit with you about the context of this potential project, as well as some specific details relating to move forward. And so many of you guys may be already aware of Chick-fil-A, but I'll share you a little bit of background about our organization and why we're here this evening. Chick-fil-A is headquartered in Atlanta, Georgia, and we are a restaurant company. We have 2,600 restaurants in 47 states. We are now in Canada and fastly growing. We are the fastest growing Chick-fil-A, we're the fastest growing chicken restaurant at the moment. We are recognizing that our businesses are certainly constrained when it comes to distribution. We are the largest privately held restaurant company in the nation. And again, serving many communities throughout the country. We currently are already using third-party distribution centers to support our restaurants, but we realize there's a need to supplement our business. If any of you guys have actually been to any of our restaurants, you recognize that it's really difficult to get into, whether that's getting into the drive-thru or perhaps getting into the dining room pre-pandemic. However, given that, that's putting constraints on our distribution network. We're realizing we're having to do evening drops. We're also recognizing we might have to do daily drops to our restaurant in order to keep up with our growing business. So adding distribution to our portfolio internally will allow us to supplement the work that's already being performed. Sorry, bear with me here in just a second. Am I missing something here? Well, we'll just talk about this slide. So one of the pillars to Chick-fil-A is obviously giving back to our community. Not only do we do that at the local restaurant, but we also do that corporately. Many of our operators do connect with our local communities on a regular basis. Some of them connecting with local nonprofits, either through Shared Table by providing excess food to local nonprofits, or to any sort of other giving initiative. And that could come in the form of scholarships, which we have many students across the nation that are receiving scholarships as a result of giving back. Primarily, we're focused on hunger, education, and homelessness, and we'll continue to reinforce all of those pillars in our giving. Since the PowerPoint has stepped away, I'll talk a little bit about... So we talked a little bit about Share Table. That's our excess food program that we have. And as we talked about, 59,000 team members have received scholarships through our program. And then, like I said, that Chick-fil-A Foundation giving, going directly to homelessness, hunger, and education. So let's talk about a project, the distribution project at hand. So we're considering Mebane as the site for this potential project. This will be the second distribution center in our Chick-fil-A network. We currently have one distribution center in Cartersville, Georgia, that's currently in operation. We opened that in 2020. So our intent is to build a 182,000 square foot facility. Our goal is to start early in 2021 and to be ready to go in early 2022. And that's very aggressive because we recognize there's a need to support operators. We anticipate 160 new full-time jobs, averaging $64,000 per job. And essentially, you're talking about all administration, warehouse staff, and truck drivers. We intend to invest $52 million into this facility with the split of $30 million for not only land and building, but then $22,000 in machinery and equipment. So again, $52 million in investment with 160 new jobs. So I'll show you the location of the potential project. So this is on Park Center Drive. There's 78 acres that we are looking at for this site. There's a cul-de-sac access that you see on Park Center Drive. And trucks will be able to get in and out for this facility. I'm happy to take any questions that the county commissioners may have regarding this project.
Any questions
about that? Well, I'm glad you're here. Jim Blackman, the best crowd food event I've been to.
Thank you.
It's good food.
Thank you.
All right, well, if you would, since anybody has any questions at this time, if you wouldn't mind standing by and we will open the public hearing.
Thank you.
So, if anybody wants to make a motion to open the public hearing?
I'll make a motion to open the public hearing.
Second.
Commissioner Boswell has made a motion to open the public hearing. It's been seconded by Commissioner Lashley. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Vice Chair Carter votes in the affirmative and the motion carries 5-0. So the public hearing on the economic development incentives for Chick-fil-A is now open. So what I will do is, and Madam Clerk, people had the opportunity to submit comments in advance or ask to be called during the public hearing. Do we have anybody take advantage of that opportunity for the Chick-fil-A public hearing?
No, not for the Chick-fil-A.
Great, thank you. So I will ask this side of the room, my left, your right, is there anybody here present who wants to be heard on the economic incentives for Chick-fil-A? And seeing no one stepping forward, I'll ask this side of the room, my right, your left, is there anyone here who wants to be heard on the economic incentives for Chick-fil-A? And please come forward, Mr. Vines. We have Henry Vines. Here tonight. Welcome.
Thank you, Commissioners. My name is Henry Vines, and this is No Camp. I know y'all would be remiss if I didn't come and speak, and so I decided I would come. I'm not an opponent of incentive. I welcome Chick-fil-A to come here. I think they would come here regardless, because this is the best place to come. We're sitting right in the middle of the state. We got easy access to north, south, east, and west. And why would you not come here? Chick-fil-A has always been a real good citizen, to the county and to the people. I mean, I've been to many school events and whatever, and they always are good to the kids. They sponsor many of the things that we've done through Farm Bureau. They are a good partner for the community. And I would just wish that they would come, because as we're going through the next 5 years, revenue is going to be important. And to basically exempt their participation in property tax for the next 5 years is going to cost us, the citizens of Alamance County, money in the long run, because when the needs are there and our property base doesn't increase, then the money's got to come. So property taxes are going to have to be increased to meet those needs. So I just throw that out to y'all. I know that I know all the arguments about being about investment down the road, and one of the things that we've talked about any of with you, is the $22 million of machinery. At the end of that 5 years, that $22 million will be reduced down to $11 million because of depreciation and the county's depreciation scale in the way it works. So I just wish you would take that into consideration. And again, Chick-fil-A, I hope you come on with us. We're good. We welcome you here. We need you. And I like Chick-fil-A sandwich too, but I wish they'd do something about that drive.
Thank you, Commissioner.
All
right, thank you, Mr. Vines. Is there anybody else
that
wants to speak about this about the economic incentives for Chick-fil-A? All right, seeing no one come forward, if we could have a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Commissioner Lashley has made a motion to close the public hearing. It's been seconded by Commissioner Boswell. If there's no discussion, all in favor of closing the public hearing, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? And Vice Chair, the motion carries 5-0 with Vice Chair Carter voting in the affirmative. Mr. Hager, can you tell us what are the incentives? What's the county doing?
So the current agreement that is in your packet indicates that Chick-fil-A is proposing to do $52 million worth of investment in real property and personal property, and to create approximately 160 new full-time jobs at the average salary of $63,375. Alamance County, if that occurs and the maximum capital investment is made and the full-time jobs are created at the level that they are projected, Alamance County is offering an incentive of $390,000 per year for a 5-year period to the company.
And is there a net positive cash lift to the county?
Yes, if Chick-fil-A makes the maximum investment and hires the number of people they're projecting, we are projecting Alamance County, after the incentives are paid, would realize a profit of
$1,479,300. And is that over the course of the 5 years?
Yes.
How much is that again?
Chairman, may I clarify, the total investment, the total incentive grant is $390,000 payable.
Was that about $390,000 cumulative over 5 years?
That's the total amount of the incentive over 5 years payable with five different 5 annual installments of $78,000.
Oh, probably so. Is that what Andrea would, was Andrea correcting me there?
Yeah.
Yes, she was.
390 over 5 years.
Okay, awesome. So is there any discussion?
Yes. Number one, I say this rhetorically and tongue-in-cheek. I believe it would have been classic for this board not to make me have a final vote on the Senate on my last night. Tongue-in-cheek. I've consistently voted against cash incentives for years. I met Senator Tony Forrest years ago about three issues at the county office. I forgot what the word said for one for sure. He said, and he was a state senator, and you're getting rid of people. Congratulations. But he sat with me in a meeting privately, and he said he didn't realize that we could give cash. Or a check, maybe. My goodness. I won't split that hair. He said he didn't realize. So I got somebody from across the hall in finance to go dig out a check that was in the file for a particular incentive deal. $35,000. Cash. That you could use it for anything. He said he was surprised. Now, that stunned me, or I was getting... Well, that stunned me. And I'm sincere here. I'm not against any business. But I also know good government, in my opinion. It doesn't make sense for something to be legal that a banker would go to jail for. If a banker offered a client, you give us your deposits, you give us your payroll, we'll give you 5%, we'll give you 3%, we'll give you 2%, whatever. It just doesn't make sense to me. Our board voted, I think we had one negative vote, to ask the state to take us out of the bidding wars. Please. High Point Greensboro came up with a resolution not to bid against one another. I don't know if they still adhere to that or not, but they passed it. I would challenge, I don't understand why you can't have tax abatements. That's against the law, to evade taxes, but you give cash. Somebody's got to someday, I hope, explain it to me before they shut the lid on me. I challenge you to go to Raleigh and try to get this Rubik's Cube solved as to why is it logical that you can't waive their taxes locally or state, but you can give them cash. So with all due respect, welcome. And that's my, and Mac Williams, I know I've been a thorn in Mac's side for years on the Sims. And I'll tell you what I told Amy here not long ago. My dad said one time he managed a lot of people in a lot of states, some pretty big plants. And he told me one time, he said, Tim, if people get together and they don't disagree, nobody's thinking. And at least you and I were thinking. You went one way, I went another. But at least we were thinking. Thank you for letting me have the time.
Are there any more comments?
Well, I, for one, am glad to see Chick-fil-A willing to come to Alamance County. And also, I don't think we actually saw the other incentives that are being offered from Nevin and Brown. Right, Matt? You mind speaking to those?
I'll come up and respond here if I may.
That'd be great.
Graham's not involved.
Oh, okay.
The facility's going to be in Nevin. So, but Nevin has approved the same incentives as offered through the county program.
So they're in line with those.
With the exception that Medlin's actually offering a little extra in terms of waivers and some fees and some but Graham's not involved in this.
Okay, I know some of the park is town
three. But it's in a different park. The site there is in a different park than where the UPS is.
I'm good. I think Chick-fil-A is a great company. Pretty good to have here.
We have any more comments? Anybody want to make a motion?
I'll make a motion for exception.
And I'll second it.
Commissioner Lashley has made a motion that we approve the board approve the economic incentives, and Commissioner Boswell has seconded it. And we'll just take a moment to note that this is not a final vote on this, that we will, at the end of this meeting, recess, and then we will reconvene virtually on Wednesday to see if there's any more public comment, and then take a final vote on that. So, public, if you're watching, you are welcome to email the county, and if you have an opinion that you want to have heard about this economic incentive, you are welcome to take advantage of that opportunity. And when we reconvene, your email will be read. Can they call too? Would there be a call-in option for that? Or is it just I guess the law says that they have 24 hours to submit a written comment, right?
That's correct.
Okay. So don't call, just write. All in favor of approving the economic development incentives, Mr. Lashley's motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
No.
Motion carries 4-1 with Commissioner Sutton voting no and with Vice Chair Carter voting in the affirmative. All right, the next item on our agenda is a public hearing for the land development plan. And I saw Jake Petrosky is on the Zoom. Jake, do you want to give us a background to the land development plan before we entertain a motion to open the public hearing?
I sure can. I did have a short presentation with that. Be the pleasure of y'all for that to happen now or later.
I think we would like to have just sort of a sketch out about what it is before the public is asked to comment on it, so they know their sort of the basic information.
So this land development plan is going to function as a comprehensive plan for the county. So it's a guiding policy document for Alamance County. It is only focused on the part of the county that's in the county jurisdiction. So towns actually have their own comprehensive plans. Burlington and Graham, Gibsonville, and all the towns, it's their responsibility to have a plan that covers the town limits and their extraterritorial jurisdictions, or the ETJs. But that being said, we did coordinate with representatives from the town during this process because it is an important document, and what happens in the county doesn't impact the towns and residents of the towns. Early on during the stakeholder involvement process, we did meet with town representatives. We had a community summit in the spring that had representatives from the county and the towns and businesses that were located in the towns and in the county jurisdiction. And also during the public survey, we also wanted to hear from folks in the cities as well. In some cases, we did kind of segment them and say, this is what everybody's saying, and this is what county residents are saying, and use that accordingly. But comprehensive plans are required by North Carolina law. In some cases, we have certain regulations, it's just a good opportunity to have a conversation at the county level and talk about what is the county doing well, what are issues that are emerging issues that we really don't have a good plan for yet, and kind of talk about concerns. So this plan, it talks about a lot of different things. Land use is one, so it talks about the future development pattern that we want to see, and really a couple of big things it wants to do is protect agriculture and rural character a little bit more than is currently done. We also spent a bit of time on economic development, parks and the environment, and infrastructure, transportation, and we also have a chapter that is really a standalone small area plan for the snow camp area. There was a lot of interest in looking at the snow camp area, really the southwestern area of the county, in a little bit more detail. So there's some specific recommendations in there that do recommend implementing new land use regulations in some form of zoning to reduce potential negative impacts of large-scale industrial and high-impact uses, and then also reduce potential conflicts between residential and agriculture. And we don't say exactly how that can be done, but we do lay out some options in plan to do so. So that's kind of a brief overview of kind of what the land development plan is.
Great, thank you. Do any commissioners have any questions about that at this time? I know that this is a great opportunity to ask questions. We've done a lot of work on this for a long time, and it's been a challenge with the virus. There's been a lot of public input, a lot of public meetings over time, which have been done virtually or with small numbers. If nobody has any questions, we could go ahead and open the public meeting.
I'll move to open the public meeting.
Second.
Okay, Commissioner Lashley has made a motion to open the public meeting, and Commissioner Boswell has seconded it. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Commissioner Vice Chair Carter, did you vote?
I thought I did, but I'll do it again.
Okay, great. Motion carries 5-0 with Vice Chair Carter voting in the affirmative. So we do have people here. I think we want to be heard on it. And we also have some people to call, and we have some email hits. So what we're going to do is hear from the people here present in person first, and then we'll do the call-ins, and then we'll read the emails. So on this side of the room, to my left, your right, is there anyone who wants to be heard on the land development plan? I know we've got some planning board members here, and people participated on the land development plan. This is your chance. And seeing nobody come forward, I'll turn to this side of the room, and I will ask if there's anybody to my right, your left, who wants to be heard about the land development plan. Henry Bynes, come. And Mr. Bynes, you participate. There was a steering committee for the land development plan, and you participated in that, is that right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I did too.
Yeah, you were there, and thank you again, commissioners, for giving me the chance to speak. There's a lot of work been done on this plan. As y'all know, it was a challenge with the COVID and everything, but we've worked hard. Jake and him have worked hard to get the input from the public, so the feedback would be there. It's what we want the county to look like. And I think this is a good plan that they put together, the A for the small area plan for the snow camp area, B for county total countywide zoning, and C for the in there for the agriculture overlay. Commissioners,
I think this is something that's been long overdue, and development in our county is at an all-time high. And if we do not control the development in a way that's going to be fair and equal to everyone, then we're going to continue the same things and the same outputs that's happened down Snow Camp. Well, at least I know that y'all have worked diligently trying to put ordinance in place. But when these things happen and then ordinance comes afterwards, it's too late. And to try to foresee all these things and put ordinance in place, I just don't see how that could be done. The folks down at Snow Camp, I understand, I feel the pain, but I also see that if we don't do something in the county-wide zoning, that I'm just about 8 miles from it, but I'm outside that plant because I'm in the little further east area. So I would appreciate y'all adopting this plan, and I hope the next board that comes ahead will take it on forward. And I know the planning board is looking forward to working with this, and I know it's a challenge. I know maybe that you've said about the expense countywide, but in my opinion, we just cannot afford to do this. We buy monies to do everything else. I don't see why that this is a very important project that we can't say getting this done. And we can do it, in stages if we had to. But to implement one part of the county in some and not the other, it's just going to drive those things to the other parts of the county, trying to rush and beat some of it in that part of the county. And again, we're losing the fall land so quickly. Just right in my neighborhood, over the last 6 months, there's a brand new development going out on 62. Took about 100 acres of some of the best farmland in this county. And these new rules of septic tanks and stuff, we'll even put these community systems in. They can put those in and put 200 or 300 houses in there. So, again, I appreciate y'all taking the initiative to ask this to be done. And I think they've done a good job, and I think it's a good plan. And thank you for your time.
Great, thank you. Is there anybody else who wants to be heard? Come back to this side of the room. Y'all sure you don't want to be heard? They are sure. They do not want to be heard. Okay. So, Madam Clerk, if we could go to the people who signed up requesting to be telephoned tonight. The first one is Dr. Gary Whitney.
Are you late me?
Yes.
Okay, you're connected to the county commissioners meeting, the public hearing of the land development plan.
Okay, thank you very much. Hi, good evening. I hope everyone's well.
We are. Hi, Dr. Lindy. This is Amy Gale, Tara Amy Gailey.
Hey, Amy.
Nice to hear from you. You have 5 minutes of public hearing comments. Give 5 minutes instead of three. And you may start whenever you're ready.
I won't take that long. First, I'd like to thank those individuals, especially our planning director, for the efforts they've put into developing this comprehensive land development plan. I believe the plan is well thought out and recognizes the geographical and cultural diversity of the county. The plan provides for several options, and I strongly support option A, as do over 70% of the residents who responded to the survey. The A plan addresses the overwhelming support for maintaining our rural and agricultural way of life while allowing well-thought-out development that fits within the culture and heritage of the county. I also wholeheartedly support the small area plan for South Camp. As you know, a flawed ordinance and poor planning permitted an intrusive heavy industrial quarry to be approved that will dramatically change the lifestyle on our peaceful farms. I do not want this mistake to be an opening for turning our community into a heavy industrial center. The small area plan will allow the citizens of our community to determine what and how much development is appropriate, and to do this in a timely fashion. Others have advocated for county-wide zoning, which could take years to develop, resulting in the continuance of a shotgun approach to landfall. The citizens of Snow Camp have spoken and are overwhelmingly supportive of controlling their own destiny. This small area plan could then serve as a template for other areas of the county to eventually have county-wide zoning. Thanks again for developing this plan, and as county officials, I hope you will follow your duty and listen to the citizens and approve first the land development plan, option A, and the Snow Camp small area plan. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Lindsay.
Okay.
All right, the next person who's requested to be called is Pam Causey.
Hello?
Ms. Causey?
Yes.
You're connected to the County Commissioner's Land Development Plan public hearing.
Thank you. I'm watching it online.
Okay. Hi, Ms. Causey. This is Chair Amy Gailey. I hope you're doing well.
Doing fine.
Good.
Thank you.
You get 5 minutes for your public comment, and you can start whenever you're ready.
Okay, thank you. Thank you all for the opportunity to tell you why I strongly support option A of the proposed small area plan for Snow Camp. I feel like we need a quick protection for the health, safety, and general welfare of our community as it relates to land use. We needed this 2 years ago, as you all know. We were a soft target and were blindsided by a company registered in Wyoming, a company that we thought was buying up land for a cattle ranch. My Allen family has lived on Quaker Bush Road and Clark Road for generations. My property adjoins the proposed quarry on two sides. My uncle's property on Clark Road is near the proposed quarry. I grew up in the community having to deal with health and safety hazards associated with a substance quarry, so I'm familiar with what all that means. I played on the playground at Sylvan School. I am a survivor of two different cancers that have been determined to not be genetic, and they are environmental. That's what the genetic counts are, I think. I don't know if there's a connection to what I was exposed to growing up or not. I just ask you to take that into consideration for the health and safety of our children. I experienced the upset in the community when a high-transmission power line came through, as well as Colonial Pipeline. Both of those crossed my plans. And now we have an investment group and a paving company that wants to come into the community. The people who are causing this dilemma don't live here. This developer and paver saw a loophole in Alamance County on a large farm for sale, and neighboring residents with pieces of property willing to sell for double the assessed value of the land. How do I know what other surprises they have in store for an unprotected community? Over the past 2 years, since several of us received certified letters in the mail, shocking us with the possibility of a crushed stone quarry and who knows what else, maybe even an asphalt plant next door here in our agricultural community. You all have listened, and I thank you. The HIDO will offer some protection, and we thank you for that too. But now we have one more request, and time is critical. We need to fix this problem that blindsided us. We need to fix it now before we're blindsided with something else. We can't afford to wait. The camp needs option A now. Please. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Causey. The next person whose request to be called is Bruce Nelson.
I'm sorry, that's so
Thank you, and thanks for listening, and I am ready. I should say I'm calling from Nashville, Tennessee. I'm away for a couple of days, but I did want to participate. Some of you know me that my family and I both have personal and business investments in Alamance County. It's our home, and we deeply care about Alamance County's future. It's in that context that I'd like the commissioners to vote tonight. I now know the new rule, though. In favor of accepting the County's Planning Commission's recommendation to approve the Alamance County land of and the small area plan for Snowcan, so-called Plan A. I am not a resident of Snowcan, but I strongly believe that decisions that impact land use, community design, transportation systems, civic values, desires, interests, and opinions of a representative group of citizens within a clearly defined small area and not a regulatory body that makes one set of rules and regulations for the entire county. One size does not fit all. A large portion of our county is rural with small town values in an urban area, not the least of which are hundreds of farms, much like ours and the farm that we land and own. Any land use planning must then take into consideration the needs and desires of the citizens, residents of smaller, clearly defined geographical areas. The Planning Commission has spent considerable time, energy, effort, financial resources, and with significant community involvement and participation. By definition, not everyone in the county agrees with the need to be more clearly defined and establish a process by which a local government grants permission for new development. Total unregulated, unplanned growth can have potentially disastrous impacts on the very fabric of our rural county and communities. The proposed snow camp line is but one example of a regulatory process that, in hindsight, is flawed. All of you are aware that the proposed snow camp small area plan is simply a plan that would restrict what kind of development would be allowed in the future of this clearly defined small area in our county. It represents a significant effort by many, including community input through surveys and virtual town meetings. Please approve that plan tonight. Use it as a model for other areas in the county to develop and shape specific small area plans for their community's future. Use the approval of that plan as a way to recognize the efforts of the many that work on this plan, and in so doing, encourage other groups to develop small area plans that fit their unique community needs. As commissioners, the fate of the Snowcat mine is no longer in your hands, nor in the hands of the Snowcat residents that will be most negatively impacted if the mine is approved to go forward. But if you approve the Snowcat small area plan tonight, Plan A, we will immediately give the citizens and residents of Snow Camp a legal and regulatory say in how future growth proceeds within their own community. Please approve this plan tonight. Give them the tools to protect them from future industrial development that has the potential to further destroy property values and the quality and the very fabric of life of Snow Camp. Thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight.
All right, thank you, Mr. Nelson. I hope you have a good evening. The next person on the list is Ron Spinhoven.
Good evening, and thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight.
Hi, Mr. Spinhoven. This is Amy Gailey, the chair. You have 5 minutes to address the board, and you can start whenever you're ready.
Thank you. That will be quick. I am a Snow Camp resident, and I'm here to express my emphatic support for the land development plan, specifically the proposed small area plan for Snow Camp, option A. As a Snow Camp resident, I've already seen our community fall victim to exploitation due to lack of regulation and oversight. In the contested approval of a permit to a ghost entity for the purchase of glass mining materials containing silicate particles, a known carcinogen. Waiting for a comprehensive countywide zoning plan could take years, if ever. Our Snow Camp community needs protection now. In fact, you might say we needed it 2 years ago. We cannot afford another bomb dropped on us like the glass mine. This is our home. We deserve the right to define our community. Four of you will no longer be commissioners come January. New commissioners will come in with far less of any history of this issue. I implore you to finish what we began by voting now to establish a small area plan for Snow Camp so that we can preserve the unique nature of our community. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Spinhoven. Right, the next person on the list requested to be called is Donna Pope.
Hello, this is Donna.
Hey, Ms. Pope, this is Amy Gailey. How are you?
Hey, Amy, I'm doing good, thank you.
Good. Well, you're connected to the commissioner meeting, and we're all here listening, and you can start your public comment for the hearing whenever you're ready. You have 5 minutes.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. Good evening, commissioners. It's good to see you all virtually. I hope you're doing well. and I'll be brief. I'd like to thank all of you for giving the green light last year for the Alamance County Land Development Plan to be contracted out, and especially for the much-needed add-on of a small area plan for Snow Camp. Thank you also to our planning director, Tanya, our county staff, the steering committee, planning board members, and all the input from hundreds of community members. As you are hearing and will be, there are many folks from the Snow Camp community asking you to approve said plan as presented, and additionally to approve option A, designate zoning district for Snow Camp now, which would take, in our understanding, only 6 months to implement versus waiting 2+ years to zone the entire county all at once. In support of this request, additionally, are the 204 and growing signatures on an ongoing petition started this past Thursday, which reads, we are asking our elected Board of County Commissioners to please vote at the public hearing on November 16, 2020, for the proposed option A small area plan for Snow Camp. We believe this plan will defend us from any future heavy industrial development, protecting our rights to a healthy and peaceful life in our small rural residential community. Thank you again for your care, leadership, and consideration, and have a good evening.
Great, thanks, Ms. Poe. Take care. All right, that's the conclusion of the people who requested that they be called tonight for the public hearing on the land development plan. But we have some emails to read. Madam Clerk, you can start working on that whenever you're ready.
Okay. First one is from Jonathan Edwards. I resoundingly support the proposed small area plan for Snow Camp in order to protect our community from industrial hazards, including air and water pollution. I support option A for urgent protections within 6 months. The next one's from Rita Williams. I support the proposed small area plan for Snow Camp. Also, please make this urgent. I request option A. Timothy Mulrooney. We support the proposed small area plan for Snow Camp. It is important to keep this area pollution free to maintain the quality of life in Snow Camp. We would also recommend option A for the Snow Camp small area plan. We have moved here for the rural, beautiful country living that Snow Camp provides. Allowing large industrial projects will take away the rural farm atmosphere of Snow Camp. Lorinda Reinhart. My husband Chris and I support the Snow Camp small area plan option A. We've been in the Snow Camp area for 29 years and in Burlington for 6 years, preceding that, and have seen a lot of changes. Many poorly thought out and executed resident concerns ignored in the Destination 2020 plan shift. It is refreshing and gives us hope that through the work of various community groups, our voices are finally being heard by our hardworking county commissioners. Love what I heard discussed in the meeting and enjoy the talks concerning roads. Thank you. John Campbell, please choose option A. Summer protection is better. We the people who live and own land in Southern Alamance County want development that does not pollute and tear up the land. Stephen Strenzel, please let's not forget we are all on the same boat on this earth. We need clean water, clean air. Why is it necessary to have industrial waste put in non-industrial areas? Well water cannot be replaced. Thank you for your time. Stephen Strenzel, Annie Jackson. Hope Rapini, I support the proposed small area plan for Snow Camp. We moved here because of the peace and quiet and enjoy being away from the big cities. We want our town to remain that way, a small town with lots of farms and open land. We don't want to have a ton of developments built or big industries come in and make a lot of noise blast. I am also asking you to choose option A and provide protection within 6 months. Robert Saget, I support the proposed small area plan for Snow Camp. Also, I urgently request for option A. Barbara Saget, I support the proposed small area plan for Snow Camp. Also, I urgently request for option A. Cheryl Braswell, my family and I love our rural community and want to feel safe and protected here. Thus, we strongly support the small area plan for Snow Camp. We also urgently request option A, protection within 6 months, be adopted. We're sure you would feel the same if you were in our position. Thank you for taking care of us. Cheryl O'Connor, I support the proposed small area plan for Snow Camp. This would allow the protection of the way of life we Snow Camp residents have come to know and love. I also urgently request option A, protection within 6 months, as opposed to option B. Ronald Saunders. My name is Ronald Saunders and I live on Clark Road, Snow Camp, and I have many concerns about how this mine will affect my family and the community. I am asking you please to help our community safely. Ricky Marley, the proposed Snow Camp mine is just the start of what can happen to our community without protections from the disruption, noise, infrastructure costs, air and water pollution that comes with heavy industry. With two North Carolina mega sites comprising over 3,300 acres already zoned for heavy industry within 15 miles of Snowcamp, we will remain a target for industrialization that would transform the fabric of our cherished rural and historic community. As property owners in the Snowcamp area, we urge the Board of Commissioners to adopt Option A, protection within 6 months of the proposed small area plan for Snowcamp. Sharon Timmons, this correspondence is intended to indicate my support for the proposed small area plan for Snowcamp. In order to preserve one of the few remaining rural agricultural and historic gems in Alamance County and the state, it is imperative to put in place protections from disruption, heavy trucks, noise, air and water pollution, and infrastructure costs. Stephen Timmons, this correspondence is intended to confirm my support for the proposed small area plan for Snowcamp. In addition, please consider this as an urgent request for Option A. Chris Lorenz, I support the proposed small area plan for Snowcamp, Option A. Patricia Aller, please vote for the proposed Alamance County Land Development Plan and Small Area Plan for Snowcamp, Option A, zoning to prevent future heavy industrial development. My family has owned 175 acres of land and paid taxes in Snowcamp for 100 years. Please support our right to maintain clean water and prevent future heavy industrial development. Patsy Bailey Aller, daughter of Pat Bailey. James Humphrey, I support the proposed small area plan for Snowcamp. Please vote for the proposed Alamance County Land Development Plan and small area plan for Snowcamp, Option A zoning to prevent future heavy industrial development. It is unconscionable to allow a company with a terrible track record on environmental issues and essentially zero accountability to destroy the quality of life for Snowcamp residents, all for corporate profits, which will of zero benefit to those same residents. Madeline S., please vote for the proposed Alamance County Land Development Plan and Small Area Plan for Snowcamp, Option A zoning, to prevent future heavy industrial development. Kevin Council, I support the proposed Small Area Plan for Snowcamp, Option A. All of us who live here, both multi-generational families and those who have lived here recently, we'd really like our community to remain the quiet, rural area we appreciate so much. Recent proposals to open a blast quarry here have made us all aware that our peaceful way of life is threatened. Our hope is the Option A for Snowcamp will help ensure that the blast quarry and other heavy industry will not be able to ruin the quality of life that we enjoy so much here in Snowcamp. Jane Lee Hicks. My name is Jane Lee Hicks, and I moved to Snowcamp just 4 years ago when I fell in love with this tranquil rural community. In the past 2 years since the proposed mine made its controversial entrance into our neighborhood, I have discovered how many of my neighbors share my love for this community. We shattered when we envisioned the impact of what a heavy industrial mining operation would mean to the air and water quality for our homes, not to mention the fear of potentially deadly explosions from the Colonial Pipeline that runs through the mining site and many of our properties. Over the past 2 years, the county commissioners appeared to share our pain as we struggled with a defective heavy industrial development ordinance that provided no opportunity for public notification, comment, or appeal for the impacts of this unwanted and unnecessary heavy industry. In response to our anguish, the commissioners have somewhat tightened the ordinance in order to thorough review of possible land development controls, including the small area development plan, specifically for Snow Camp. There are less than 15 miles from two North Carolina mega sites comprising more than 3,300 acres. And without the protection of the small area development proposal, we are sitting up for additional noxious heavy industrial development. I am fearful that clever land use attorneys who are adept at passing state legislation that favors industry to find workarounds to our hideout. Our community needs the immediate protection provided by option A, small area development plan, if we are to protect the very fabric of the Snow Camp community. By selecting option A for immediate implementation, you in no way prevent any of the two options for the county to consider now or in the future. Our community is asking you to hear our pleas and approve option A. Thank you for your consideration and for the outgoing commissioners, your thoughtful service to our community. Mary Longhill, I support the proposed small area plan for Snow Camp and urgently want option A. I have lived on our farm in Snow Camp for 40 years and want this beautiful community to continue that way. And that is all of the written comments, Madam Chair.
Thank you so much. That was a lot. That was 22 written comments. And thank you to the public for taking the time and taking advantage of the opportunity to submit written comments and also to call. Pretty cool. So I know that there's going to be a lot of questions and discussions, especially wanting to learn more about option A, what the land development plan is, and what the commissioners are being asked to vote on tonight. We're going to hear more from Dave Petrosky about that, but is there anybody else who wants to be heard in the public hearing? If not, we'd
interview. Sure.
Oh, I'm sorry, man. I didn't see you back there. I guess I should put my glasses on. Please come up to the podium.
I wasn't providing an agenda, so
I beg your pardon?
I wasn't providing an agenda so I know what I'd be speaking on.
Okay, ma'am, well let me explain what we're doing right now. This is a public hearing on a land development plan. And so if you have comments that are directly related to the land development plan, then you are welcome to make those now. But if you have comments about another issue or another item, then you would this would not be the time to do that.
Okay. What would be the time?
Here, he's got an agenda for you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Is there anybody else?
I'll make a motion to close the public hearing then.
Okay, Commissioner Boswell has made a motion to close the public hearing. It has been seconded by Commissioner Lashley. If there's no discussion, all in favor of closing the public hearing, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? I believe that Commissioner Vice Chair Carter, did you vote aye?
I did.
Okay, so the motion carries 5-0 with Commissioner Vice Chair Carter voting in the affirmative. All right, Jay Petrosky or Tom Cattle, our planning director, is here. Can we get some more information about what the land development plan is, and particularly the options that we've heard so much about in the public comment, and what is it that we would be voting to approve tonight?
Jake, do you want to go over that part? I think you've got a slide or something. Do y'all want to go ahead and do his presentation? She has a short presentation about what we're here for and comments and things that we've gotten some amendments to the planning you all have.
Yeah, that would be, this would be the time to do all of that.
Jake, it's all yours.
Can you all see my screen?
Yeah.
Okay, great. I can answer that during this presentation. So I want to just talk a little bit about the project and recommendations and changes that happened since the public version of the plan, next steps, and then we have some discussion. Part of that next steps, we'll talk about those options. So the purpose of this land development plan is to promote the public health, safety, and welfare of the county citizens, guide and manage growth and change and strengthen different communities within the county. Public guide investments, improve the quality of life for residents, attract and maintain businesses. The schedule for the plan, we began this plan back in September of 2019. We've done a lot of public engagement along the way. We've had a number of surveys, in-person meetings, virtual meetings. As Mr. Vines mentioned, the pandemic did throw a wrench in things, but we moved a lot of things virtually. We got a lot of feedback. We had over 1,600 responses to the surveys overall. Just a lot of feedback throughout the process, so it's been very surprising, very good. One of the big things we're trying to tackle is growth in the county. The population of Alamance County has grown since 2000, and about a third of that growth has happened in the county jurisdiction as opposed to the towns. One thing that we asked about during this process was, do folks, do residents of the county think additional measures should be put in place to manage growth and or high impact development? And 79% of the survey responses indicate that they do support additional measures to manage growth and high impact uses. One thing that we did during the process was we talked about the potential land use policy options that we had before us. One is a business as usual option where we don't really try to influence the way land use and development happen in county jurisdiction, and there would be more widespread, pretty dense residential essentially throughout the county, strict commercial development, that sort of thing. And then we developed two other scenarios, managed growth scenario and agricultural and rural character scenario. And these were aimed at different things. The managed growth was really aimed at protecting environmental assets and allowing some growth in certain areas. And the agricultural and rural character scenario really was focused on protecting agriculture and rural character in the county. And about 74% of response wanted the agricultural and rural character scenario. But there was significant support for the managed growth scenario. So we used those two scenarios heavily on the agriculture and rural character scenario to develop a future land use plan. So that's kind of the basis for the future land use recommendations. The draft plan has been available and is available on AlamanceCountyPlan.com for a couple months now, and has a number of goals and recommendation for each of these goals. The future land use map is a critical part of this. This is meant to illustrate future development pattern in the county jurisdiction. Focusing growth on near municipalities is one thing that the plan does. And really, it's the municipal growth area, the orange area, is the ETJ in town limits. So what happens within there, there could be a blend of things. There could be some areas the town want to focus growth in and areas that they don't want to grow. But that is really just, you know, what they want to do. But outside of that, it's a urban transition area where there is some residential growth and some more as possible. And then rural residential areas where you want to protect the rural character and agricultural area where you really want to focus on agricultural operations. You have some opportunities for commercial employment uses. Rural centers, the pink bubbles are existing centers of businesses, some civic uses. Hill villages are kind of like a unique thing that you want to support and enforce. And then employment centers, where there's some, most of the non-residential uses and then non-residential property tax value, about 90% in Alamance County as a whole is inside ETJs, is inside cities in their extraterritorial jurisdiction. That's likely to continue, that trend, but we do want to point out some areas of for that growth in the county jurisdiction. And protection of rural character in less developed areas and decreased development pressure in agriculture areas is a really important part of this. Protecting and promoting agriculture. So one thing that we had in here is some policies related to that and some ways to do that. Discouraging high density, large scale subdivisions in rural residential and agricultural areas is recommended in this plan. Nine requirements for new neighborhoods that reduce the impacts on agricultural operations and existing neighbors, and also promoting agriculture in the county. When no bona fide farms are exempt from zoning regulation, but without updates to the county subdivision regulations and or some form of zoning, farms will be impacted by projected residential development and potential non-residential developments in the future, and that's really driving some of the land use recommendations in this plan. So we had some recommendations for the county as a whole, but we also included some specific recommendations for the snow camp area, the greater snow camp area, really the southwestern part of the county. And part of this plan identified what makes the community of snow camp unique, and it establishes a set of guidelines to manage growth in those areas, balancing economic development, businesses and natural resources, and agricultural operations, supporting the historical significance of the area, and some implementation strategies associated with that. A couple big recommendations are encourage a development pattern that's consistent with the small area plan and the land use plan, allowing only low density residential development in order to reduce conflicts with agriculture, preserving natural and historical assets of Stedham, encouraging the preservation of historic structure, rural views, and natural features as part of that. Updating the subdivision ordinance is something that can be done to help that increase in lot size and implement open space requirements. We are also recommending the restricting high impact land uses in the study area. A more extensive review and approval process is needed for large scale residential commercial development. Heavy industry wind mines, considering implementing additional regulations to manage growth and high impact uses is recommended. So considering some form of zoning in the snow camp area or the county as a whole to really focus on preserving agricultural and rural character, we recommend it. A couple of notes here, the county already regulates use and subdivision, in some cases through a series of ordinances. To implement the zoning ordinance, additional steps would be needed from the administrative side of things and actually crafting the zoning ordinance. Right now, five counties in North Carolina do not have zoning. Alamance County is the largest and the fastest growing county without zoning in the state. An example of what we're trying to do with this, we have a number of model zoning district or zoning recommendations in the Centennial area, which is in districts, on the residential side of things, under your current regulations, you can have pretty dense residential development throughout the county. It really is dependent on availability of utilities, and quality of soil, and whether developers are able to afford to put in a septic system or community well system. But you have really, really small lots, and you don't have any open space requirements. And you can see that if you're an adjacent landowner here, if you have a farm operation on the north side of this property on the left, you could have 30 new homes against your property or more, potentially. What we would recommend is during implementation of zoning, is to encourage more sensitive design. We're not saying that there can't be residential. We need to balance property owners' interest and preserve their options for encouraging residential or allowing residential on the property. But we also want to do it in a sensitive manner and protect existing residents, cultural assets, agricultural operations. So lower density development that has some design criteria is what we're recommending. Kind of on the right is an example of what we recommend. So low density overall, just a better design. So how we implement this plan? You lay out some options for implementation within the plan. These options, and I can go through them and talk through them, but it should be noted that the plan itself does not implement zoning. The plan recommends implementing zoning, and there's a number of different ways to do that. These options are in the plan that outline three different ways, potentially four different ways of implementing zoning. So although there's a lot of support for option A, and there's some support for option B, approval of the plan as it currently is does not say we are doing option A right now. I think that we can have some discussion around that, but just know that as it stands, it will be at the discretion of the board after the plan is approved how to proceed with implementation. With that being said, there was some adjustment made desired for this option to change what's in this on this page. But let me go through the options. Option A would be implement zoning in the southwest for the Smith Camp area only initially. It would require probably four zoning districts, an agricultural district, a rural residential district, commercial or mixed use district, and then industrial district that would require a special use permit process for rezoning. This option could be the first of many phases. You make some recommendations in the plan about future small area plans. And with this option of implementing zoning, you could implement zoning in the southwest and then begin a small area plan for another part of the county to determine what types of issues need to be addressed or could be addressed with additional land use regulations in those areas. This would allow the customization of zoning recommendations for different areas. Option B would be countywide zoning. You would need a number of additional zoning districts to account for different existing development, potential development in the county. It would be a much larger effort than the Southwest only, but it could address concerns that exist in other parts of the county. As you heard from some of the public comments, there is a lot of concern with growth and development in other parts of the county. Say in the southeast, in the north, there's a lot of things to lose with widespread development in different other areas of the county. So that is option B. To give you an understanding of kind of level of effort, the Smith Camp area, the southwest area, has about 3,400 parcels, tax parcels. And if you're looking at the county jurisdiction countywide, that number is north of 30,000. So that would be, applying zoning, doing the due diligence to apply zoning, at roughly 10 times the number of tax parcels. So that's why we have a level of effort estimate here. Option A would be a medium level effort, still significant effort, but option B would be a high, higher small level of effort. Option C is an agricultural zoning district overlay for either the Southwest or a portion of the Southwest, or countywide or a portion of countywide. This is really meant to just look at the agricultural area, protect those areas, or be a placeholder zoning district until more detailed planning comes through. The planning board did discuss these options in a lot of detail over a number of meetings. There was support, and they included in the resolution to approve the plan. They wanted to include another optional or mention of an option to go with option A, but also look at doing some sort of agricultural zoning overlay or a more simpler process for zoning the rest of the county. So some combination of option A and C is what they wanted to include, right? to look at in when you look at implementation of this document. There were some changes that were recommended by staff and the planning board. Agricultural operations and submit their exemption from range regulation, and some potential other exemptions when the county crafts the zoning districts. Agritourism include a mention of these and encourage mentions to encourage these uses in rural residential and agricultural areas, and then also consider a performance-based approach to permitting these uses based on make sure that you have parcel size or parking or like on the uses that you can't regulate. Transportation, this was, we brought this up at the planning board meeting based on the conversation on the board's meeting at the last meeting, and the addition of a recommendation related to studying future east-west transportation improvements in conjunction with the municipalities in Burlington, Grant, and Pierre was added. And then there's some minor future land use map edits to match parcel lines better than north. And then E is to add that language for zoning implementation option that blends option A and option C. So those were part of the planning board resolution. We did get some public comments on the draft plan. In addition to those that we read tonight, we got some public comments from the planning board meeting. They were generally supportive of the draft plan, and some expressed support for either option A or countywide zoning. There was a few public comments on online feedback form that we had up. One was a support for residential lot size restrictions, and restrictions to industrial industrial businesses countywide, not just in Snow Camp. And then there was some concern about suburban growth north of Gibsonville and the need to preserve historic farms and heritage. Some minor text changes suggested. And this is a map on the right that shows the future land use map and the suburban transition area. That is that yellow area north of Gibsonville is probably the area that they're was concerned about. We do have a recommendation, even in those suburban transition areas, to increase open space requirements and not at a minimum lot sizes, even in those areas. So that should be noted. Next steps, we've had the public review of the draft plan since October, and then we had a planning board meeting on the 15th. The first one, we came to the Board of Commissioners for information session on November 2nd, had our planning board meeting on the 12th, and then here we are tonight. So the discussion and approval options. So consideration of changes recommended as part of the planning board resolution. Discussion of any additional changes needed to the plan will be something that you all can discuss. And then the motion options, motion to approve the plan, motion to approve the plan as changes suggested as part of the planning board recommendation. Or you can, and you can add any additional changes that you see fit. And this is just an example of motion that you know, we're trying to put together, so have something as a basis for discussion. That's my presentation. Happy to answer any questions and elaborate on anything. Wanted to keep it kind of short since you saw a lot of that presentation that you're asking.
All right, so thank you, Jake. If you don't mind if I jump in with the question, because I've been, you know, participating in these meetings and stuff, but I have a question. So if we approve the plan, does that commit to an option A, B, or C? Or if we use the example motion that's presented here, if we did that with the changes recommended by the planning board on November 12th, does that commit the board to an option tonight?
No, it does not. You will have to get staff direction on how to proceed. And it would probably be recommended that you ask staff for staff recommendation and have get some.
Jake, I'm going to interrupt you. We're going to have a recess. Let's take a 10-minute recess. All right, ladies and gentlemen, it looks like we're ready to come back to the session from the recess. We were talking about the land development plan and understanding that if we approve the land development plan or if we adopt this motion as presented with the changes recommended by the planning board, that the Board of Commissioners is not committed to a particular option, and that implementation is different from the policy recommendations. Is that a good way to put it?
That sure is. You know, we've consulted with legal all the way through this process, and specifically I was supposed to be in the last week or so before we got to the planning board point. We've brought a lot of presentations to you all, and there's been a lot of discussion on the implementation part and options, and that is a very valid discussion. For tonight, though, what we're looking at is the entire document. There's no option to be picked tonight, as legal has told me in so many words, is you've got to make the plan before you can make a consistency statement to implement the plan. So once we implement this plan, y'all see it. When you do the HIDO and everything, I have a consistency statement that we acknowledge when we implement HIDOs or solar system, whatever we have. That has to be consistent with your land development plan. So we've got to make a plan, and then the implementation will come after that. And we have to write a consistency statement. Whatever route we choose for implementation, we write that consistency plan to be consistent with the land development plan that's approved. So this has to be approved by itself in its entirety, unless there's a few changes on it. And then when it's time and implementation comes, the board will make the decision on which way to go and say it's consistent with the land development plan. And it can be all of some of Jake's giving you a bunch of options, and we can even make that change and go with A and B or B and C or however the board wants to go when it's time to make that happen. The zoning options. So we just want to be clear, tonight is not a choice of options, even though we've had a lot of support for certain options. The whole plan tonight is what's being reviewed for.
And we're within 2 weeks of the new board.
That's correct.
Now, what accessibility would they have for this process?
Well, so, you know, the goal when we started this plan was to have it done before December of this year. So we have strived to make sure we can protect all of you through the COVID stuff. So the new board, depending on who you all vote tonight, if you all approve this plan, the new board will work from the plan on whatever implementation and recommendations they would like to take from the plan and make happen.
So we basically just have to approve the plan as written. And we can do the small area plan.
Small area plan is part of this plan. It's not really seen as a separate document. So if you approve the land development plan, it is included. Are you good with that?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Now, you'll see, planning board made some of the recommended changes, just the things that Jacob put on the front end, there's some edits and a few minor changes to the map that we would recommend y'all as well adopting, because those changes are not in the plan just yet, and then any additional changes you'd like to make.
But Tanya, if I could just add one thing.
Go ahead, Jake.
Is it also fair to say that if y'all really, you know, felt, you know, unanimous and strong about, you know, one option, option C here, option B here, option A, and you could, you know, adopt a plan and say, you know, delete all those options and just include that option. You know, that is one of y'all's options, but, you know, the drawback of that is, you know, staff has not provided information, this has not had time to provide information on level of effort required, either those options or combination of options, and you know, potential time frames and cost of, you know, you'd have some rough estimates of that, but you know, that is, it's recommended from project team, staff, and us that we leave those options on the table and have more discussion on how to implement very shortly after the plan is adopted.
I think that's the best comfort zone, to give all our options out there, and then whatever needs to happen, because we don't have a crystal ball, we can't see what's going to happen, or else we just say mine. So we want to leave all our options open to see what we want to do and not limit ourselves.
Well, I think I'll fix it. Can I make a motion? We're going to make a motion that we adopt the plan.
With the changes recommended?
As the changes recommended.
And I'll start that deal. And I think we need to move on to this and then process for a new board coming up.
Vice Chair Carter, did you have any comments or questions that you wanted
to? Not at this point.
Okay. Well, we have a motion by Mr. Lashley to adopt the plan with the changes recommended by the planning board, and a second by Commissioner Boswell. If there's no further discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Anyone opposed? And so the motion carries 5-0 with Vice Chair Carter voting in the affirmative. But we have to do that again, because this is another 24-hour situation where the public has 24 hours to provide a written comment. And so when we recess at the end of this meeting, and then reconvene at 10 o'clock on Wednesday morning, this will be an item which we take up again along with the economic development incentives for Chick-fil-A. Great. All right, so now on the agenda, we're at item 8, number 2, approval or consideration of an application for the Inspire Grant for Small Museums. And Brian Baker, our very capable and wonderful director of parks, is going to present.
Thank you for the introduction. Good evening. I am here on behalf of the Recreation and Parks Department to seek permission to apply for the Inspire Grant for Small Museums. So this is part of our partnership of the Parks Department with the Monco Textile Heritage Museum. I've had many opportunities to come up here and update you on that partnership over the past 2 years, but it's been very successful for both our department and for the museum. We were on track pre-COVID to double attendance at the museum in that short period of time. We've been shut down for a while, but attendance was well up, and I'm also happy to announce tonight that we've had some progress with the buildings in Glencoe, and that the museum has been able to acquire the superintendent's house, which is the city house across the street from the museum. So that will be acquired with private funds, and will be part of the museum going forward. This grant is to help us tell the story of Glencoe and the Southern Textile Mill Village story a little bit better. So this is a grant that will help us get some professionals who know how to do museum displays and tell that story inside the museum, including in the new house. So it's a $40,000 grant made available from the Institution of Museums and Library Services. There is no county match required. I'll be happy to answer any questions you might have about the grant.
I just want to make a comment that, you know, the NALS did a great job getting that going, and it really is a lot of our history running in the county. And I think it's great that we get more to help, because I know it takes a lot to keep those other buildings up, be able to show them off.
It does. It is the best preserved textile mill village in the United States, and so we're lucky to have that here now in the county.
I'd like the motion to approve.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion by Commissioner Lashley and a second by Commissioner Boswell. Are there any more questions or comments?
Couldn't really hear him back here.
If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And hear him back here.
And Vice Chair Carter, did you vote?
I did.
And was it, you voted in the affirmative? Okay, so the motion carries 5-0, and Vice Chair Carter votes in the affirmative. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is a COVID-19 update from Alex Rimmer, our interim health director.
Hey, good evening, Commissioner.
Good evening.
So we're going to take a look tonight at the COVID dashboard, just for an update. So again, the dashboard updates every day at 1 o'clock. So today we have 89 new cases, 6,480 cumulative confirmed cases since the beginning of COVID in Alamance County. We've had 5,845 released from isolation. We currently have 524 active cases. 27 of the 524 are receiving hospital care. Sadly, to report 111 deaths. 1,184 close contacts being monitored, and 11,324 that have been released. So as you can see on the daily cases, we're continuing to see really high numbers. There are throughout the state. So we're definitely not alone in this, and all of the counties surrounding us are as well. So we'll go down and take a look at things sensitivized with code. Just as we would expect, Burlington, Copper, East Burlington, that's where some of the higher numbers are. And if you hover over again, you can see how many cumulative there have been. And scrolling down, we'll go look at weekly testing. So the most recent percent positivity, when you hover over that, is 6.4%. And last week we saw a little over 4,600 tests in the community. So the increase for testing demands have recently gone up. And so we've been seeing a lot of testing at Cone Health and other places throughout the county. And we'll scroll down. The distribution of cases versus county population has remained relatively stable throughout COVID. Again, we're seeing the highest in the 20 through 44 range. And then as we go down, we'll take a look at race and ethnicity. And again, very similar numbers to before. So, I know we talked about the COVID dashboard through NCDHHS and how they're talking a lot about where the cases coming from and that kind of thing. So we're still seeing the majority of our cases from small gatherings and social events. And the majority of cases are in the general population. And so they're not coming necessarily from folks in quarantine. They're coming from just general population. So they're being seen in workplaces, educational settings, any type of small gathering. So very, very similar to what we've been seeing before. We have seen a rise with phase three. And so as we go into Thanksgiving, just a reminder to the community that the governor recently did change the indoor limits to 10. And there's a lot of good information on NCDHHS about how to stay safe over Thanksgiving. Did any of you all have any other questions?
I promised I wasn't going to ask you anything for myself. I said, wish you happy Thanksgiving.
Thank
you. All right, now, still mean that. Will you roll back to the initial dashboard?
Of course.
And you show 524 active cases.
Yes, sir.
Now, will you find for me active cases?
Yeah, so that is someone that's in isolation. So they're within typically that 10-day period of isolation that you would see. Sometimes folks are in a little bit longer, depending on when they're fever-free and if their symptoms are getting better and improving. So that's going to be the people in isolation that have had a positive COVID test.
Now, what, in your professional opinion, say the bridges, what do you think the numbers are 524 is going to wind up in your release category? Now, I know it's cycle through, it rolls over, but what percentage of that, as we're looking at right now, those 524 do you think will wind up in the release from, whatever the word is,
isolation?
Yeah. What percentage, if you had to throw a figure at it?
As those active cases come out of their isolation period, they would be moved into release from isolation as far as the numbers go, or they would be moved to the death. So the categories break down. As I know last commissioner meeting, we talked a lot about where the death's coming from, and a significant number of them are coming from long-term care facilities just because of the age groups that are in those facilities and the congregate living setting that kind of thing.
But it's very possible that the vast majority of 524 can wind up, and if we cut it off of that, just know that the vast majority of this 524 will wind up in the release. It's possible.
Potentially when you look at the number of deaths. Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's what I'm interested in. And you know, when we had a small discussion about deaths, I don't want to pin down on that either. And you had to hear back about it. But the bottom line is the death rate in the United States now is 8.9% nationally, every year. Has been for years. So you have your death rate, you have your birth rate, and you have your net gain, okay? 2% or something like that. I'm not sure what it is. But that's why I wanted to know the numbers of deaths in Alamance County, not just since COVID, but 2 years prior, you know, 2 year to date. Prior, I think it'll show either a trend up or a trend the same, or maybe a trend drop. I doubt it's a drop. That's why I asked you. But anyway, thank you, and I've enjoyed it. Appreciate the best, and have a good
day.
You didn't have anything about Elon. Are they going home for the holidays?
They are. So they're returning home. A lot of them are already have been, and they're continuing to return home this week.
And I guess they've got somewhat under control.
They have. Yes, sir. I just wanted to let y'all know I have really enjoyed working with all of you and getting to speak to you in my interim health director role. And I really appreciate all the support and all the great questions that you all ask.
And you're going to go back to environmental health?
I am, yes. Yeah, I took the preparedness coordinator position, but I'll still be an on-site.
We did an
outstanding job.
Tell
Dean Harrison that I'm going to call every now and then and ask him a question.
I will make sure to keep your number saved in that phone. All right, thank you.
Thank you so much. We're all best. Yeah, why aren't you wearing a mask? And you.
We're going to recess this meeting until Wednesday morning at 10 o'clock. We're going to reconvene it. And we will finish the rest of the remaining items on the agenda at that time. So we are in recess until Wednesday at 10 o'clock, which will be our virtual meeting. Thank you. We'll come.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Local Gov TV. please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGovTV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.